So today we have two teams, and both are from Maplewood Richmond Heights High School. Go Maplewood. In our final round. So today what we're going to be, the teams of four members compete to represent each side of the resolution. And today the resolution is resolved. It is appropriate that the United States government should make manned space exploration a funded priority for NASA. And I'm going to repeat it, and this is important for you to pay attention as audience members, because you get a vote. How many of you received a small slip of paper when you came in? Leave it. You got it? Great. That's because you get to vote. So there will be five votes deciding the winner of this debate. There are the four judges. And then the last vote will come from the audience. Whatever the majority of the audience says, which team will be decided, will be the winner. So let me introduce the teams to you. First, let's start with the pro team over here. First, we have, and please stand when I read your name, Mr. John O'Keefe.
They're not programmed to detect weirdness, the unimaginable, the unknown, the strange non-carbon life that may be encountered on Mars. For example, with the two Viking vehicles in 76. Each carried equipment for sampling the Martian soil and miniature chemistry laboratories to test the samples for signs of life. The results these automated labs radioed back to Earth were enigmatic. Most scientists examining the results reluctantly concluded that it was lifeless. The chemical reactions observed could have been the results of Martian life. They certainly were not ordinary in organic chemistry. The debate over the meaning of the Viking results is still unsettled more than 30 years later. But a human biologist or biochemist on the scene could have learned a lot more and settled the matter one way or the other within a few hours. Because humans do what robots cannot. Part of the problem is the limited abilities and scope of each robotic mission. To save money and reduce failure rates, robotic probes are stripped down to the bare essentials. Although these probes gather important data, much of it is ambiguous for the lack of the probe's ability to do follow-up tests. Today's robots cannot start up new lines of investigation. Raw data is useful, but often raises more questions. Even worse, the data is often completely unexpected, leaving the scientists at a loss to explain the results. They need further missions to run different tests, and the cornerstone of all good science, verification by repeatedly testing the same area over time. This repeated testing of results becomes difficult with unmanned mission failure rates. Take the Mars exploration programs. Out of 31 missions by the US, the USSR, Russia, and Japan since 1960, all but 10 failed and only 5 met their original goals. Compare that to the high success rates of astronaut missions, almost 90%. While probe data is useful, they contend that one mission of a live scientist could answer all of their questions in a few weeks, while endless robotic probes may never be able to find a clear picture. A scientist can apply all of his or her senses to quickly make determinations as to what to study and what to ignore. The human has much more acute vision than even the best video cameras, and more importantly, can process data with the solar system's best supercomputer, the human brain, right on the spot. Robots really need to have the ability to adapt and modify their behaviors to conform to changing needs and requirements that they will encounter in space. For that, we need humans in space exploration, because humans do what robots cannot. Thank you.
Favorable conditions for microbial life. These discoveries were possible because the Mars rovers did not require the support systems that a human would need and could stay on the planet for many years. The long lifespans of interplanetary robots have allowed for even more discoveries from other probes. The Galileo spacecraft discovered that Jupiter's great red spots were really storms and that Io has volcanoes. It found that Europa has a cold ocean underneath its ice. The Cassini-Huygens probe made major achievements, including proving Einstein's theory of general relativity, that space-time is curved, and that light bends around gravity. NASA is currently managing 65 robotic space probes, from the Hubble telescope to space radiation probes and interplanetary craft. These unmanned probes monitor the sun's composition, solar flares, and sunspots. They're helping us learn more about the Earth, Mars, and other planets. Even though humans have left no footprints on Mars or Jupiter's moon Europa, our space robots at these destinations have beamed back to us compelling evidence of the presence of water. These discoveries fire our imaginations with the prospect of finding life on future missions. Four of our earlier space probes were launched with enough energy and the right trajectory to escape our solar system altogether, each one carrying encoded information about humans for the intelligent aliens who might require the hardware in the future. 40 more unmanned probes are in various stages of development. These missions seek to understand dark matter in the universe, and others will search for more planets in distant solar systems. We also maintain hundreds of communication satellites, as well as a dozen space-based telescopes that see the universe in different bands of light. In particular, the microwave band allows us to see the edge of the observable universe, where we find evidence of the Big Bang. Space agencies in Europe, Russia, Japan, India, and China are running or building their own robotic craft. Robots are successfully collecting information across the universe for countries around the globe. As computers become more capable and reliable, machines of greater complexity will be built to handle even more challenging assignments. With every advance in robotics and miniaturization, the practical case for human exploration gets weaker and weaker. Therefore, our team contends that it is not appropriate for our government to fund human space exploration. It costs 50 times more money to send a human to a destination in space than it does to send a robot. You could send a scientist to Mars with a rock hammer and a few machines to make measurements. You could do that once. Or you could fund 50 different rovers that could be placed anywhere you want on the Martian surface with the measuring machines on board. Scientifically, it's a no-brainer. Because of the price difference, any scientist interested in scientific results would not send a human there. I'd rather send the 50 robots.
Specialized mask weighing less than 3 ounces to protect the physically impaired from injuries to the face and head. Flexible heat resistant material developed to protect the space shuttle on re-entry and are now being used by both firefighters and the military. None of these advancements would have been created for robots. They are intended to protect human lives in space and continue to save lives on Earth today. How about food safety? Well, NASA invented a system to assure the astronauts on the way to the moon would not get food poisoning. Their seven-step guide was developed to monitor and test food production. 25 years later, the Food and Drug Administration and the Agricultural Department adopted the safety systems for all of us, and a year later, according to the industry, the number of salmonella increased by 50%. NASA also helped develop a microalgae-based nutritional supplement that can be used as a food supply on long-term space missions. These contain an omega-3 fatty acid called DHA, which aids in the development of the function of the brain, eyes, and heart. Today, this supplement is included in nearly all baby formulas in the United States, as well as those sold in more than 75 countries around the world, and it's used in numerous other foods, including milk, yogurt, pasta, and bread. NASA technologies are also helping improving the environment. To sustain the astronauts living on the International Space Station and future moon space missions, NASA engineers are developing systems that create drinkable water from respiration, sweat, and urine. Commercially, the system is benefiting people all over the world who need affordable clean water, especially in remote locations, by combining the benefits of chemical absorption, ion exchange, and ultrafiltration process. This technology can yield safe, drinkable water for even the most challenging sources, such as undeveloped regions where water may be heavily contaminated. What is the cost of all these numerous advancements? 0.5% of each tax dollar. Half a penny. Even in the Apollo era, peak NASA spending amounted to a little more than 4 cents on the dollar. That's less than 1% of the US budget. The space program provides overwhelming benefits, improving the technology and life of others. Imagine if the other 99% of the US budget was invested as wisely and provided as many stunning results. Where would we be today?
Against man's stating that the space shuttle and the International Space Station were not the right path. The cost of the shuttle program was nearly $200 billion, while the ISS has cost taxpayers over $150 billion. NASA justified this cost by citing its incredible potential. NASA Administrator Daniel Goldman promised, "When we finish, the ISS will be a premier world-class laboratory in low Earth orbit that promises to yield insights, science, and information, the likes of which we cannot fully comprehend as we stand here at the beginning." But the ISS hasn't become a center of science. Most of the research done aboard the station deals with the survival in space, instead of advancements in basic science that could affect life back on the ground. There have been about 500 American experiments and 800 international ones on the ISS, but they have produced comparatively little scientific literature. By comparison, NASA's Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy Probe has generated more than three times as many papers for one-tenth of the cost. And the unmanned Hubble telescope has an even more impressive legacy. More research papers have been published using its data than have ever been published for any scientific instrument in any discipline. Clearly, humans are not needed in space to accomplish great science. Obama acknowledged the need for change when he said, "Nobody is more committed to the human exploration of space than I am, but we've got to do it in a smart way. We can't keep doing the same old things as before." He seeks to revive NASA with clear aims and a larger purpose, and to shift the responsibility for space transportation to private companies. This offers a refreshing alternative to government programs that spend lots of money to accomplish too little. Private space exploration companies are already emerging, such as SpaceX, Mojave Aerospace Ventures, and Virgin Galactic. These companies have made significant advances, including deployment of satellites, docking with the space station, and successful flight of a multi-stage rocket. Future investments should not be tied to the public sector. The private sector is a better investor. NASA's had too many missions that have been paid for, but failed. The National Aerospace Plane cost us $1.7 billion, but nothing was built. The X-33 sought to produce a reusable stage-to-orbit spacecraft, but the program was canceled after $1.2 billion was spent. NASA also created the Space Launch Initiative, spending $800 million drawing blueprints for the proposed shuttle replacements. Nothing was built, and the program was scrapped. Private investment is better because only the companies bear the cost of the failures. For these reasons, our team contends that it is not appropriate for our government to fund human space exploration.
We're entering another generation of no progress in terms of human flight in space. We stand a big chance of losing the ability to inspire the youth. We want the next generation to look forward to more than a new way to watch videos on their cell phones. We want them to look forward to the excitement of exploration the way people did decades ago. We want them to look forward to things that are really important. When President Kennedy set the goal of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to Earth, he sparked excitement in the hearts of Americans. His challenge created a generation of scientists and engineers that not only took people to the moon, but were also responsible for the comforts and technology that surrounds us. Today, the United States has fallen from the 3rd to 15th place in producing scientists and engineers. What does that tell you? This country has stopped advancing. The drive, the inspiration that was very much alive 50 years ago, is gone now. Youth needs a vision, something to look forward to, because no one is going to try and work if there is no goal. This lack of vision has led to a precipitous decline in science literacy among all American citizens. Science literacy is not how many chemical formulas you can write, nor whether you know how your microwave works. Science literacy is being plugged into the forces that power the universe. Shockingly, 1 in 5 Americans still think that the sun revolves around the Earth, a notion that was invented in the 16th century. There is no excuse for thinking that the sun, a million times the size of the Earth, orbits Earth. We need the MAN program to inspire youth to know more about the world around them, engaging them in exploration of challenging questions and involving them in high-quality intellectual work. Some people have claimed that the space shuttle and International Space Station have failed to generate interest from the general public. I don't believe that for a minute. When NASA announced that the Hubble telescope would no longer be serviced, the loudest voice of dissent were from the general public. A modern version of a torch-wielding mob voiced their opposition in every medium available, from co-ops to petitions. People don't just rally because they have nothing better to do. They rally because they care. show that a resounding 80% people support continuation of manned programs. Indeed, support for astronauts extends well beyond simple bawling. People are spending money to go into space as tourists. Chapters of the Mars Society exist in almost every major country, all pushing for manned missions with goals like human exploration of Mars. There is no doubt that people care, and the United States government should provide a spark of inspiration to keep it strong. Space exploration is an inseparable part of American culture. What is the most popular museum in the world? It's not the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, nor the British Museum. With almost 9 million visitors per year, it's the Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C., which has everything from the Wright Brothers' original 1903 airplane to Apollo 11 moon capsule. International visitors are anxious to see the air and space aircrafts housed in this museum because they are an American legacy to the world. The heart and soul of NASA's mission is the sheer joy of exploration and discovery. Not all countries offer their citizens this possibility. People living in poor countries are used to three biological imperatives: food, shelter, and reproduction. Ignore those basic requirements and you'll go extinct. But in wealthy nations, we can go beyond the basics. We have time to reflect on our place in cosmos. We might think of this as a luxury, but it is not. Exploration and discovery express the biological imperative of our brain. To deny these yearnings is a travesty of nature. It is not true that people's interest in space exploration is gone. Only by seeing people who passionately explore space can awaken the sense of excitement, joy, and exploration. Years of manned space missions have shown that a handful of those who go there can become heroes to us, billions of average people on Earth. We develop that special connection with humans, not robots. Nobody's ever given a parade for a robot. Nobody's ever named a high school after a robot. We perceive events through the experience of others, and this is exactly why it is appropriate to continue sending people to space.
Exposure to radiation oxidative damage to the astronauts' bodies. In addition to all of these negative effects from radiation, there are numerous ways that the human body falls apart because of the absence of gravity. If astronauts ever reached Mars, there would be no Neil Armstrong moment where the capsule pilot bounced down the ladder to claim Mars for mankind. Weightlessness causes the human body to lose 1 to 2% of its bone mineral density each month. Time spent in zero gravity also has serious effects on the muscle physiology and the cardiovascular system. The return from zero gravity to one gravity leads to an inability to maintain an appropriate blood pressure when in an upright position and insufficient blood flow to the brain. So after months of bone decaying travel, pilots to Mars would be incapacitated in their module for days or even weeks, acclimating to the Martian gravity. The ability of astronauts to perform basic tasks when they land would be severely impaired. The psychological effects of extended space travel are also known. According to NASA's 2009 Human Research Program report, as 6 or 7 people are placed in a confined space for 18 months and sent to a place nobody's been before, with no way to escape, they are likely to experience stress, tension, and even severe psychiatric problems. Based on studies in Antarctica and other isolated environments, the report cited the risk of increased human performance errors due to sleep loss, fatigue, overload, and circadian desynchronization. Cosmonauts squabbles aboard the Russian Mir space station brought one mission home ahead of time, while NASA has also reported crew disputes among its astronauts. Even the simplest of situations can be major life or death struggles in space. Food poisoning or injury could render the crew helpless. Our astronauts could be dying in space while we watch them poke. Space is a hostile place for humans. The perils are far greater than any other feat of exploration in history. Sending people to space may be a great show, but it is done at the cost of endangered human lives. It is not appropriate for our government to fund these incredibly dangerous missions. Sending humans into space is the riskiest venture ever undertaken. The Apollo, Challenger, and Columbia accidents caused 17 deaths, and we should not continue to risk human lives.
Roughly 9. that size were to hit Earth today, roughly 500 million people would be killed within the first 24 hours. In 2001, researchers at the California Institute of Technology analyzed helium isotopes from sediments left from Manson impact and concluded that it affected the Earth's climate for roughly 10,000 years. As we have seen from recent events, meteorites hit Earth frequently. Large ones are rare, but have hit Earth many times over millions of years. Humans have only been around for a fraction of this time, and we have yet to experience a truly colossal meteorite impact. It is not a matter of if a meteorite will hit Earth, it is a matter of when. These life-threatening events are an example of a problem that cannot be solved using robots. The only way to lessen the chance of humans being wiped out by a large meteorite is to colonize multiple planets. This means sending humans into space. The idea of long-distance space travel seems impossible, and right now it is. We have yet to develop a rocket that can escape the Earth's gravity and then have enough fuel to make a long-distance trip to another planet. Although the obstacles we face are large, the idea of being obliterated by a meteorite is very good motivation. With the current obsession of replacing humans with robots in space, we have stopped developing the technologies that make human space travel possible, increasing the odds that we will be forever stuck on Earth. Although the International Space Station and other satellites serve great purposes, we seem to have forgotten that it is possible to venture out farther than the Earth's orbit. There will always be many reasons not to send humans into space. But I believe our will to survive might be stronger than our will to furnish the cosmos with rovers and satellites. Human space travel should go on for no reason other than to ensure the continuity of the human race. Alone, this should be enough justification for us all.
Nervous governments worry about the political backlash if something goes wrong.
No surprise, the added weight for redundant safety and life support systems making trips back from the planet and sometimes make this utterly impractical. Between 1960 and 1962, both the U.S. and the Soviet Union sent probes to both Mars and Venus, and a consensus of the next likely step was a manned mission to another planet, most likely Mars. Our closest neighbor, Venus, with its atmosphere of carbon dioxide and surface temperature of around 460 degrees Celsius, would never be suitable for humans. Temperatures on Mars are not that much better. While it can reach 20 degrees Celsius in the summer, the average temperature is 50 degrees below, and it plummets to a negative 140 degrees Celsius in the winter, which is completely unsuitable for human habitation. The forays to Mars so far have not been unqualified successes. One crashed without trace, another safely landed, but was apparently too damaged to send back any data. The only successful manned capsule re-entries to Earth have been where the capsules have not been required again for reuse. The Martian gravity is much stronger than the Moon's, and so the terminal velocity on Mars would be much higher, leading to higher impact landing. There is always the chance that some components could be damaged in any attempt. It is ludicrous to consider funding manned missions until we can first develop robotic landers that can safely return to Earth. The other moral question is how could any country justify such spending of limited scientific values to mankind when there are so much many more oppressing problems to be addressed here on Earth? Thank you.